good to see you all. Thanks for coming. I'd like to welcome you to the first talk of the term, which is given by Alexandra Stolzing from the University of Loughborough. She's a senior lecturer in regenerative medicine, and tonight she's going to talk to us about stem cell technologies and their role in making us smart. So I'd like to welcome you all to Alexandra's talk.
Yeah, thank you very much for the invitation. As I didn't know kind of like what background to expect and level of knowledge of you guys about stem cells, it will be a mixed talk, yeah? So a little bit of history of stem cell therapies, a little bit of current work I'm doing at Loughborough and of course in Leipzig, and hopefully also a little bit of kind of where the field is moving to. So regeneration. So I'm interested in using the stem cells actually as a tool to develop therapies. And it's kind of interesting to study other organisms in nature and to see how they are regenerating. And these are some examples. As you can see here, this is a worm. It's having a very high regenerative capacity. That's a lobster. Also, this animal is regenerating very fast and very extensively. And this here, this is kind of us, this human. And here we are in a state where we also very regenerative active. You could actually take out one of these cells and the whole would still regenerate and it would still produce a human being. And this is also a very nice and ethical way of producing embryonic stem cells. If you want to avoid all that ethical issue of you killing to derive embryonic stem cells. This is just showing you kind of like we also have regenerative potential and it's all based on stem cells. So if you look at the tissues in the body and kind of their regeneration capacity, then we have all tissues which are highly reproducible or are highly proliferative. So our skin is constantly regenerating and it's all powered by stem cells. And then we have intermediate and you can't forget about the bones, they're also turning over, also the muscles. And then we have tissue like cartilage, which are really, really difficult because they don't really turn over very much. And we definitely have the brain, and the structure is quite conserved, it's not turning over very much. So to give you a little bit of introduction, we have to talk a little bit about stem cell hierarchy, so to understand what we're really talking about when we talk about stem cells, because there are many, many, many different types of stem cells. So there's here, the totipotent stem cell, and that is a cell which can make really everything of the body. And also it can make, kind of reproduce the human body in total. And that's pluripotent stem cell. It's kind of like the next down in the lineage, and it's a little bit restricted. So what we define is actually that the pluripotent stem cell is having a very high cell renewal capacity, so it can make more of its own and can conserve its own kind of potential. And then further down, we have progenitors. So this kind of like stem cells which are a little bit restricted, they usually make only one tissue type or only one germline. So for example, there is the mesodermal lineage, and mesodermal progenitors would only make kind of muscles, bone, cartilage. So this is, and then, yeah, we have at the end here specialized cells. And these progenitors, they are restricted. They don't make more stem cells. So actually, the potential to make more stem cells is lost somewhere here. So we have to be careful, like when we see stem cell therapies, it sometimes means that we're actually working on the level of progenitors and not actual stem cells. You have to also understand that in history, the field has kind of naturally grown, and every scientist likes to call the stem cells in another name. And it made it also quite complicated because we have now different stem cell names, and they're not kind of like in the system, they have not been evolved in a system. So it's sometimes very difficult to know what we're talking about. So to go and they can make multiple types of specialized cells, but not all tissue stem cells are multipotent. So you also have more restricted ones. To give you an imagination how it looks, here are the hematopoietic stem cells. That's actually the stem cell type which is best understood in the field. And it all starts with cells in the bone marrow. And this is kind of what we know, how are their kind of progenitor levels and also what cell types in the end they make. So this is the most researched field where we actually know quite a bit about the things, but there's still some kind of like levels where we don't know if, for example, this can turn into this stem cell or what is kind of like the progenitor of dendritic cells. So it's a still evolving field. Where can we find them? We can find them more or less everywhere in the body. So we have neuronal stem cells in the brain, we have liver stem cells in the eye, we have skin cells, breast stem cells, we have many, many stem cells in the gut, testicles, muscles, bone marrow. So it's, I made kind of like a bet that there wouldn't be a piece of the human body which wouldn't contain kind of one type of stem cells, because it all kind of is necessary to maintain the tissue. So when you think about stem cells and stem cell therapy, often people are not aware that actually that it's something quite known and quite old. So just wanted to show you the first actual stem cell therapy was 1956. So it's quite old, it's kind of like already established therapy. So that was using peripheral blood stem cells obtained from blood. So it's kind of like around quite some time. And there were a German report looking at how many Europeans actually had kind of in vitro produced skin or cartilage or bone in the body, and there were already 25,000 in 2012. And that means this is kind of in vitro from stem cell or cells derived tissue types. So they're all around us, and stem cell therapy and also regenerative medicine is kind of reality. Parkinson is one area where stem cells have been used also very, very long. What we're actually using here is fetal brain tissue. We isolate the cells from these. They're kind of like separated, and then they're transplanted into the brain of the infant, so in the human brain. And so the first patients were treated in 1988, and only 1995 were the first scientific report of it. But as you might imagine, the problem is really the raw material, because this is fetal tissue, so it's from abortion. It's not easy to get that material. Many people have ethical problems to use this kind of material, but it works very well. The only problem is you have to repeat it. So it kind of works for a couple of years, and the patients are really fine, but then they need a new transplantation. And also usually one donation is not enough to treat the therapy, so you also need several kind of fetuses to treat the patient. So it's actually, if you imagine like every Parkinson patient in the world will need a stem cell therapy, how many fetuses would you need? So what we're trying to do is finding replacement for these kind of cells. Another area which was kind of like around since long is this bone and tissue engineered bone. So it's 1998 now. It was the first patient which got like this scaffolds, so basically a supporting surface for the stem cells, because you have to imagine that this is kind of like a big hole in the bone, and if you would just transplant the cells in, they would be kind of washed out. So you need actually a surface to keep the cell in place until they have turned into bone and fused together. So this is what you see here later on, is that all of these parts have been turned into normal kind of natural bone, and you can't really tell anymore that there was a hole here. So this is also kind of where tissue engineering comes into the cell therapy field. So stem cells or stem cell therapy often need kind of supporting surfaces or supporting substances to work. The first, what the field called organ, tissue-engineered organ, was 1999, and it was a kind of very simple, it is a bladder, and it was engineered from autologous cells, again, together with the scaffold, for the cells to grow on and kind of make a shape, so that it would keep this the shape, and the cells would grow on this. And this was actually then transplanted into humans, and there have been kind of, it was in the USA, and there have also been follow-up studies. So now a lot of children and youngsters have been treated, which naturally had like a non-functional bladder. So also kind of interesting as a milestone in the field, because it counts as like the first tissue-engineered organ. The first stem cell therapy for the heart was in 2003. So a young boy again in America, very successful. The more kind of complicated stuff now coming together also with design. So we had a case where we had a reconstruction of the bone in the face. So basically they got again a scaffold to support the cells and put them into the right shape. That was computer designed. And then we had kind of bone marrow stem cells seeded into it, and it was transplanted below the skin of the patient so that it could be vascularized, because otherwise such a big tissue would not survive. So you needed to be vascularized. And then after a couple of weeks, it was kind of transplanted into the face, and it naturally integrated, and the patient is quite happy. So it is, as I said, like, computer-aided scaffold, and it was later, it was in Germany in 2004. The first therapy for the eye in 2005, this time it's a group from London. So what they did is they took limbal stem cells here from the eye, from a healthy eye, they cultured it, and then transplanted it into a diseased eye, and basically cured the diseased eye. To show how stem cell therapy could also potentially kind of like have an impact on the next generation, I had this publication here, where now we can also make spermatogonial stem cells, and they have been transplanted in the rhesus testes, and they have made new sperms. So potentially also kind of like issues around infertility could soon be solved, but they were still very kind of conservative about it, because they didn't know how it would translate into humans, because basically there's no human material to work on, and we don't understand much about the spermatogenesis in humans. And also for the females, we can help along with oocytes. So here we had like oocyte made from primordial bone stem cells in mice, and they actually had like offspring. So it's kind of like there is no tissue in the body or no organ, or it seems like no disease we could not cure. So the question is actually kind of like what are they doing like in the field, like why are we not seeing more of it? So if you want to see what else is out there, and maybe you have a specific question or a specific disease you're interested in, maybe you have like somebody in your family which is ill and you want to find a clinical trial, and then this is where you actually go, is the website which is contain all actual clinical trials on stem cells. So if you want to search this, just type it in, and you will see how many there are actually. So I have done this and have looked, like there's currently 1,779 recruiting clinical trials using stem cells, 500 of it in Europe alone, and 245 in the UK. So it's a huge amount. It's only in German. These are the types of stem cells investigated or used. So it's neural stem cells, mesenchymal stem cells, hematopoietic stem cells, and embryonic stem cells. So you also see kind of the cell types they're using. So question is, could I actually buy a stem cell therapy? Can I buy like a tissue engineer? product? Yes, you can. There are kind of like a couple of products on the market. Here's one example for cartilage. So it's a very simple tissue. That's why we can make it. It's only one cell type. It's not muscularized. And at least in Germany and another couple of other countries, it's actually paid for by the health insurer. So if you have like a broken cartilage somewhere in the body, you can get a replacement based on stem cells. And there's another product on the market, and it's skin. So you could actually buy little pieces of skin, which made in this case here from stem cells, which are the kind of the root of your hair. It's a very nice way of isolating stem cells because it's kind of not very invasive. It's here you see like the hair root, and from there stem cells are growing out, and then again you can make kind of fibroblasts and keratinocytes out of it. Again, it's a simple tissue. It's one, and sometimes it's two cell types. It's not vascularized for, and you could also get it on the health insurer paid for. This is how it looks like. If you have, for example, an open wound, like you have often in diabetic patients, you have like non-healing wounds, and they use these little pieces of artificial skin to cover it, and then usually it heals very well. And just to show you how it kind of comes to the clinic, it's like a little package. You can just open it, put it on the wound. You could even imagine it doing it at home. So it's a kind of like very nicely designed product. So the question is, why there are not more on the market? Like, if it all sounds so fantastic, we all have these success stories, why is there not more? Like, why can I not cure all my diseases with stem cells? So I try to illustrate a little bit where the problems are in the field. And one problem is actually the European Medicine Agency, so it's kind of the regulator looking at what cell therapies are allowed. And they have big problems of kind of regulating stem cell therapies because it's a complicated product. It's not a simple chemist thing, it's not a pill. It's a complicated living tissue, what you're actually regulating. And they haven't really made up their mind of what they demand of the researcher or the industry of what their safety is and what their standard is. So basically, they don't know the rules, so we don't know to adhere to the rules, so it's kind of like complicated to get these cell products into the market. And then another reason is cost. So here's one company, they have reported how much they have spent actually on their cellular therapy products, and also how much clinical trials actually cost. And you always have to go through clinical trials with your stem cell product. So here they show that it was $10 million for 100 patients. And if you see this amount of money, then you know why not more is kind of like in the market, because in the moment, the costs are kind of really, really high. And then reason three is because many products actually fail. Yeah. So if you look at one patient, you get all these sensor kind of like nice stories, nice newspapers, things like I showed you in the beginning is, oh, fantastic, we cured one boy. But then you go into clinical trial and you have suddenly 100 or maybe 1,000 patients. And then many stem cell therapy nowadays have reports showing that their product is not better than current alternative therapies. And this is kind of like also stopping the field because you have to imagine you have put so much money into it, then your clinical trial fails, and then you're actually bankrupt. So you don't have the kind of power to go back to science, go back into the lab, look at why failed the therapy, and then maybe improve your product. So that's why in the moment we have only one kind of like approved, what we call ATMP, that's an advanced therapy medical product. So it could be a cell or a tissue. And so we only have one approved in the EU, and that's for the eye. And then another reason why the cell therapy trial failed is actually that we are more heterogeneous, and also our cells, we are kind of donating are very heterogeneous. So we don't know in a moment the relationship between the donor variability and the therapy outcome. So we're not very homogeneous. And mice are very homogeneous. So in mice, I can kind of like treat a lot of diseases. But if I actually go into the human population, a lot of my therapies fail because they don't take into account that we are all different. So stem cell products are not very personalized. That's one of the, I think, reasons why they fail. So what do I do maybe to solve some of these problems? I have picked actually two areas I want to address, and one is that my donors in my clinical trials are usually very old, because that's when a lot of diseases the stem cells are trying to cure appear. So Alzheimer, degenerative diseases of the cartilage, muscles, heart infarcts, strokes, it all kind of like is more common in the elderly. So I try to understand how age impacts on stem cell quality and stem cell efficacy. And the other reason this is kind of like, this is more towards the cost side of the product, is in a moment, usually the product is made by hand, like one scientist sitting at a bench creating the stem cells. So it's all very cost and time intensive. And what we try to do in Loughborough is to make it into kind of like a very automated, cost-effective product. So we're trying to really automate stem cell production. To show you a little bit of kind of like how aging impacts on therapy outcome, don't go into details, it's just like showing that these all are studies in kind of mouse models or rodent models. It hasn't even reached the clinic yet to look at aging and how aging impacts on the therapy outcomes. So all of these studies have compared young stem cells from young donors and aged stem cells from older or elderly donors. And they find that in 11 out of 12 cases which have been reported, that donor age has a negative impact. So one of the things we really have to look for is how we deal with it. So do we only take young donors? But that's sometimes a problem, for example, for bone marrow transplantation, where you have to match the donor to the recipient. So you cannot take like any kind of person from the street and say, like, give me your stem cells. So it's not that easy to solve that problem. So I'm looking at ways in rejuvenating stem cells, so making them actually younger, and then use them in a therapy. This is just showing you some how critical age is. This is bone marrow, and we isolated mucous stem cells from the bone marrow. And this is just showing the donor age, that's human donors. So you see, like, if you up to 20 years, you have pretty kind of like enough stem cells, so they're pretty high. But if I look at 21 to 40, it's not very old, like in terms of years, or we don't feel that old, but there's already a significant drop here in stem cell number. And that's a problem, because for stem cell therapy, I usually need a lot of cells, like 10 to the 7, 10 to 8, 10 to 9 is kind of the doses often given in therapies. So if I already start with low numbers and then have to expand them, and it's aging the cells as well, that's really kind of like problematic. And then if you look at, this is osteogenesis, so this is the ability of the stem cells to turn into bone. Here I also include like a group over 60, you see again there's a significant reduction of the ability to stem cells to turn into bone. So if I look at tissue engineering products, I also have to deal with that problem. So they don't make bone that easily. So I have to find ways to nurture them along to still make bone. And also, more extreme here is this cartilage production, so chondrogenesis. You see here that the stem cells in the over 60, when you actually need cartilage, the ability of the stem cell to make cartilage is nearly gone. So you would need a lot of cells, which are all bad at making stem cells, cartilage. So it's not very effective. And then we wonder why stem cell clinical trials are failing. It's because a lot of them are using autologous cells. And if there's no therapeutic potential left, then yes, they have to fail. And the other problem we're trying to solve, and that's specifically in Loughborough, is kind of like this vision. So this is a project I have worked in before. It's kind of like, it's an automated system. So this is fully automated. You don't need any human to feed it. And what we're producing is one of these skin tissue engineering products. So basically, you put in cells in here, and at the end, you get loads of skin produced. So it can run 7 days a week, 24 hours a day. I don't need any personnel. I occasionally need to clean it, kind of once a month, but that's it. So I only need kind of cost for media, but I don't have any personnel costs anymore. And that was all made like with different Fraunhofer institutes together, some trying to solve the engineering issues, some solving the biology issues. And if you're lucky, you really get this nice skin and mate. So this is just showing kind of like, I think, where the field is moving to. So we are moving into automatization to decrease cost. So after this a little bit negative thing, anything positive to report? Is there anything kind of like, is there a future in stem cell therapies, or should we all stop it and stop wasting money? And I think yes, and that's why I'm working in stem cell therapy, and I want to give like a little bit of introduction of what I personally as doing in the stem cell therapy field. So I'm interested in neurodegeneration. For example, one of my targets is Alzheimer. So it came from my PhD studies, actually, where I looked specifically at how a certain cell type in the brain is functioning and how it's changing with age. And it's the microglia cell. So it's part of the immune system. And the cell usually is combating in bacterial infections. But it's also meant to take or to phagocytose protein aggregates, which appear normally in life. So this is one of these plaques, and in Alzheimer's, it's the amyloid. You might have heard about it, amyloid plaques. So usually, if they appear, the microglia gets activated, it migrates to the plaque, it eats the plaques, and everything is fine, and problem solved. But the problem is that with age, their ability to migrate is inhibited, and also their ability to degrade the material is kind of decreased. So basically the cells have, over their lifetime, done this again and again, and are kind of now running out of power. So what now happens is that the cells are still kind of getting activated, so they're still trying to eat the amyloid plaque. And this is signaling, or this is producing signals which are dangerous for the neurons. So this is how kind of like I think Alzheimer really starts. So there's a vicious cycle of constant activation, and it leads to kind of like a circle where the cells are constantly activated, trying to resolve the problem and thereby damaging the neuron. So over time, you get like neurodegeneration. So my idea was to combat this problem is to bring in stem cells from outside, and they would hopefully kind of mend the microglia kind of impairment and clearing up the system. And this is how we actually did it. So we had some Alzheimer's mice. It's how we usually start with a model. We used mesenchymal stem cells from a mouse strain which is green, so that's fluorescent light, so that I can actually detect the cells. And we also compared young and aged donors, but that's not so important for the moment. And then we isolated the brain, the organs, and I did kind of like cell countings and analysis. And this shows you kind of like the cortex area and all these little green dots And if you go into one of these amyloid plaques, then you actually find them also that they're invading in this area. So somehow they seem to be attracted to places where there is damage. And if you then look at all these little dots, again, are amyloid plaques. So you might have seen, like, in the past, some human brains with also these plaques. It's very similar in the mouse model. And here you have injected human stem cells sort of after 7 days or 28 days, and you see that kind of the number of points are reduced. And also, if you quantify that, you see that it's a bit complicated. So here you see that actually the amount of middle-sized plaques is reduced, and the amount of very small plaques is increased. So if you think about it, the cells start degrading the plaques. So what you have is less of the bigger ones and more of the small ones. So it's not like the stem cells have cleared up the pathology completely, but it's only 7 and 28 days, so maybe they need a little bit more kind of work and time. But what we also know is they seem to be not doing anything with very large plaques. Also, if you kind of look at the microglia cells, which are also part of the inflammation, so the damaging part in this disease, is you see that all of the black parts are microglia cells, so they all kind of, it's bad if you have these many, and after the stem cell therapy, you have really basically decreased amounts of this. So they look very much like a brain of a young mouse. And then if you really go into the inflammation system, TNF alpha is a very well-known marker of inflammation, also IL-6. You see those can be reduced by transplanting the mesenchymal stem cells. So that's kind of my thinking, and also like where do we go like in the future with kind of like what can the stem cell really do for us is here one study using again the same types of stem cells, the mesenchymal stem cells, and they have transplanted into aged mice. They were actually interested in using the cells to combat osteoporosis. And here you see the young bone, so it's kind of like just cut through the bone, and you want a lot of these material here, so the trabecular bone. And then you see how in old mice it's all whole, it's kind of empty and black, and then you see here with young bone marrow stem cells, it's filling up. And if you, again, take old bone marrow, it's not working very well. So that was actually what their goal was. But just by accident, they also found that the mesenchymal stem cells are apparently delaying aging. So if you look at that curve, that's a survival course. It shows you basically when a mice dies. And you see that with the young bone marrow transplantation, It's the dark hole here, it's the outer one. It's actually showing lifespan here. So it seems that the young stem cells extending life of the mice. So quite exciting, but it's only mice. So another idea here is, can we actually kind of use them? Oh, sorry, I mistyped that. Intelligence. So again, a mouse model only. Here they used human astrocytes, so not stem cells, but astrocytes, so everything in green are human cells transplanted into the mouse brain. And what they found was that if they looked at intelligence in a mice, so they looked here at how quickly the mice are learning, and chimeric means they have the human astrocytes in the brain. So if you look at that curve, they're much, much quicker in learning than the allograft, that means mouse cells transplanted. And you also see that in another test, also another learning-based test, you see that chimeric mice with the human astrocytes are learning much, much quicker. So you could think that there is maybe a lot in stem cell therapy which we have not exploited in the moment. So it's not all about maybe curing diseases, it's maybe also about lifespan and health and also intelligence, maybe also strength and things like this. So yeah, this is what I wanted to present you, and I also wanted to show you, this is us. integrating, so we bring together scientists from chemistry, physics, computer science, material science, and bring it all together to solve kind of problems in the field, speeding up stem cell therapies and regenerative medicine. And then hopefully you have lots of questions.
I've been told that the market for stem cells in Japan is quite well developed, that it's bigger than the market in the US and Europe combined. Could you perhaps tell us something about in what way it is developable from an academic and commercial point of view in Japan?
I think it's academically it's not so different to the UK or the rest of Europe, but in terms of regulations it's different. So for example, Japan came up with a new idea of how to solve the problem with deregulation, which I showed you. So the way of making it more interesting for companies to invest this vast amount of money into stem cell therapies is that they are allowing the commercial partners to get revenue much earlier. So they could go into clinical trials, what we call phase two or so, and they could already charge the people. So they get, instead of paying everything, they get money back from the government. And that's quite, I think, attractive. And also there's a general kind of social side to it. So the society in Japan seems to be more open to engineering and kind of these kind of solving of diseases and problems. So they're more open to these kind of tissue engineering products. While in Europe and maybe also in America, we're more conservative and also more safety concerned. So in Europe, we always have to show kind of like the negative, that there is never any side effect. And I think that's not so much a problem in Japan. So maybe that's why they're more successful. But also the government is funding it with a lot of money. They're trying to do the same here. So they have kind of like funded the catapult in London. It's a center where stem cell therapy should be kind of like commercialized. So to help the academics with their nice ideas, which work in a lab, to actually bring into the market. So UK is trying to solve that problem. Questions?
You mentioned you induced pluripotent stem cells.
Yes.
Or just elaborate slightly.
Yeah, okay. So that is a way of making pluripotent stem cells from kind of any somatic cell. Somatic cell means non-stem cell. So I basically could take a stem cell, or not a stem cell, I could take a cell from your skin and make that into something which resembles an embryonic stem cell. So basically, you're introducing a couple of factors we know which are controlling pluripotency. It was all invented by Yamanaka and somebody also from the UK, Gurdon. So they both together, got like the Nobel Prize for this idea of making pluripotent stem cells out of non-human stem cells. And therefore giving us a tool as an alternative to the embryonic stem cells. Does it answer the question?
So what a lot of this handling of the cells, to me as a non-experimentalist, it seems like it's rather rough. These are small, fragile things, and you're kind of pouring chemicals on them, moving in test tubes, injecting them, and doing all sorts of harsh stuff. So, there is obviously a regenerative level, but do we know something about what kind of damage we get? What's the risk of, let's say, a chromosomal or mutational damage to the stem cells as we go through these processes?
Definitely. So for the embryonic stem cell field, it's a known fact. They are kind of immortal in the culture, but we know that there is chromosomal damage accumulating over time. So yes, it's not in a natural environment, it's a very artificial environment, and it is inducing DNA damage, chromosomal damage. So we always have control, kind of control before we release such a stem cell therapy to kind of human level. Yes, we have to look at that. Yes, we also understand many of the things inducing damage. We're not so good at solving these problems because usually it involves more handling and more costs. So kind of like it's a balance. that people are not doing it, so they don't have a solution for that problem.
How easy is it to get the stem cells to cross the blood-brain barrier?
Ah, very good question. So there, for a long, long time, people said more or less that unless there's a disease or you irradiate the mice, that the blood-brain barrier will be closed and not open to the cells. But I think more and more people understand that also the stem cells can actively cross the blood-brain barrier. Also our own cells can migrate into the brain. It usually don't happen like on a kind of regular basis and not many cells, but the cells can actively cross the blood-brain barrier. But at the moment we have no understanding of how often it happens, what receptors are involved, how it's kind of changed when you have like a disease. So the only thing we know is that in diseases like Alzheimer's, you have more signals in the brain attracting stem cells. So you have chemokines which are released from brain cells, and the MSCs or other cells can actually detect them and can migrate towards them. But I can't give you an answer on that. So basically, we only see them appearing in the brain, but that's everything.
What's the biggest thing we can do? Is it organs?
I think the limb would be really kind of very, very complicated in the moment because you need a lot of things to work together. So you could probably build something which has a bone in it and some muscle attached and skin around it. But what we lack in the moment is really innovation. So the link of the limb then to the central nervous system. So that I think in the moment is not solved. And the other problem would really be getting enough cells. So you would need either a lot of embryonic stem cells to start with or a lot of donor material. So yeah, maybe in a couple of years. There are some American groups working on printing cells, so using 3D printing technology to actually solve that problem. So kind of a computer scientist could measure like your other leg, then invert it, and then kind of like build a scaffold, and then a machine could layer by layer print the cells and also different cell types. But the technology has only been used to kind of like create very, very thin layers of cells. So I would say it's still a couple of years until we could print something large.
Yeah, and do you think induced pluripotent stem cells will ever be able to supersede the demand we have for embryonic stem cells or germ cells?
As they are not exactly like embryonic stem cells, I, as a scientist, would say we still need embryonic stem cells to understand what the cells can do and how pluripotency is regulated. Because induced pluripotent stem cells are still like kind of like a little bit different from natural embryonic stem cells. So I would argue we need those models. Induced pluripotent stem cells can be made from diseased donors, and I think that's their beauty, because you could then have Alzheimer's a bad example, but maybe you could have like different diseases in addition. So you could study mechanistics, you can study kind of basic questions around the disease. And most embryonic stem cell lines derived came from normal, non-diseased donors. But I would still say we need them.
Can you see in the near future that stem cells will compete with standard treatments for chronic disease?
I think if we rework how we are paying for treatments, then I think I see a future in it. But you have to imagine, like in the moment, what we're thinking is like there's 1 year and what costs I have in that year to treat one patient. And then stem cells will be more expensive because they might cost $50,000. Instead of $100, maybe. So, but if you look at the broader perspective and you follow it over time, then you don't need, like, for example, with the open wounds, the skin is healing really, really nicely. So So in the moment, it would require a daily change of the dressing, and it's quite expensive over time. But if you only look back at 1 year, it's much cheaper than the stem cells. But until we have kind of like taken this into account, it's not that attractive to use stem cell products. So this is one part of the answer. And the other is we have to massively reduce cost of the product. Because, for example, some of the cancer treatments available in the moment would cost 50,000, 100,000 pounds, and that's too much. So we have to see that we're reducing how much kind of like this generation of the cells cost, and then also it's more attractive. It's still kind of like a balance, because also stem cell being used in clinic means that the clinician needs extra training to actually handle the cells, because they are not, again, they are not like a syringe or a dressing. If you mishandle them, as he mentioned, like if you treat them badly, they're damaged and then they don't work. So that's also something we have to kind of like take into account. And if we have thought about like how we do that, like if we have specialized center which only do stem cell therapies, then maybe then become more common.
Are there any discussions or things happening around like storing the embryonic stem cells during birth that create some kind of stem cell bank or something for the future treatment in case it ever comes up?
I think what you are addressing is not the embryonic stem cells being kind of stored at birth, but the umbilical cord blood or cord tissue,
uh-huh.
And there are many banks around. So we have commercial banks and we also have state-funded banks. So yes, they are already stored in the moment, and in a couple of cases they have already been used to treat patients. So definitely, if you can afford it, I think it's quite sensible to store them. I have seen one publication where they have actually used a product which was frozen down for 27 years. That's quite a long time. So yeah, they are still functional. It's not perfect because also this process has not been very well kind of optimized, but still the cells are still functional. But you lose some to the bad conditions.
Would you like to discuss a little bit about the news that was in the media about the stress-induced stem cell paper? What was the point, and why would a piece like or a journal like Nature fall for that? Is it that simple to? Because you talked about iPS cells, is it really that simple to convert adult cells into stem-like stem?
Okay, maybe I have to explain a little bit more what a stress paper is. So in the moment, most of the induced pluripotent stem cells are made using virus. And the virus is integrating in your genome and kind of like changing your genome. And we don't know where they integrate. Most of the time, they can randomly integrate anywhere in your genome. And it can also be in the tumor suppressor region, and then that might kind of be a risk if you use the cells. So for a long time in the field, it was very, very attractive to finding ways of reprogramming the cells, not using a virus. So people have come up with lots of things like using proteins, RNAs, so chemistry, peptides, I don't know. They have kind of thrown everything at cells to see if they could make induced pluripotent stem cells. And one paper reported they have just stressed them enough, and then they have kind of like reprogrammed back into something which is like a pluripotent stem cell, and then it turned out to be fake. And to answer the question, yes, it's very easy to fake such a paper. There have been studies around trying to look how much of the reports are actually fabricated, like absolutely made up, not something kind of by accident or slightly changed, but really made up from scratch. And yeah, they're not so, but we have many cases. This is was just like one. There was a cloning case from Korea, which was mostly fake, not totally fake, but we have these cases. And Nature is not more protected from it than any other journal. They also use referees, and if they look at the data and it looks like being true, how should they know? So unless we find software or other solutions to check the quality of the data, it will be hard to kind of find these fakes. And to say, like, it's not that easy to have non-virus reprogramming. It's quite tricky. Most of the cells are kind of too stressed and they simply die. So you have to do it quite often to come up with one stable IPS line, but it works. Yeah?
What sort of genetic changes do these viruses introduce?
Well, they are kind of like, you have to imagine we need, depending on the protocol, we need 4 protein factors to reprogram a cell. And it's a couple of hundred nucleotides which you have to get into your genome. And the virus can integrate several times. So you could have like long stretches of your DNA kind of modified. And it can have all sorts of problems with it. It might be in a region where it doesn't matter at all because there's no active gene and nothing happens. Or as I said, like it could be in a tumor suppressor gene and then you would lose the activity of this tumor suppressor and you are more likely then to develop cancer because you don't have the safety feature in your cells. But it can also just maybe integrate somewhere where the hormone is overproduced and maybe you're growing more and kind of like all sorts of things could happen. We can't really predict because the integration is random. Yeah.
How do these 4 proteins on one and the new transcription factors on another, how do they actually reprogram the cell?
I would say we don't know exactly how it works. It's kind of like you bring in a factor which the cell had kind of like shut down. So we all had it when we were still kind of like a stem cell ball. So we all had these factors active in the cells. And over time, they're shut down. So what you do is you bring in these factors, which are kind of what we call the pluripotency factor. And what happens is that you kind of like create a loop where your internal proteins are activated to be produced again. And it's kind of a very complicated regulatory system. So with a couple of transcription factors, though, they are all mostly all transcription factors, so they all regulate more than one gene. They're activating whole sequences of genes. But the exact thing, kind of like what step is required and in what sequence, we don't know. Generally, what happens is that the genome gets demethylated, so kind of like set back to zero, and this is how kind of then the pluripotency is kept. Like it's your imprinting to be a specialized cell is kind of like removed, and therefore you are blank again. Okay. Yep.
I can imagine that you sparked quite some interest now for getting grants and funds that are available for stem cell research. We still see an increase in the grants and the funds, or has it died down a bit after a certain time?
I would say there are high kind of like times where there's a lot of funding apparently, and then it dies down. And in the moment, I would say okay, but it depends on where in the process you are. Like, are you just looking at the basic function of stem cells, or at you at the clinical side? And for some of these kind of like regions, there's no funding at all, and for other sites, there's kind of plenty of funding available. So I wouldn't say that stem cell will always kind of like make you run more successful just because you have the name stem cells in it. So we are kind of like past this time, so it's more tight the budget. But for I would say that by basic side of understanding stem cells and also kind of studying diseases, there's plenty, or maybe kind of like okay-ish money, but there's really a gap when you go from mouse and you want them to go to clinic. That's where you have to find either company or investors to pay the bill.
Are there a lot of companies investing in stem cells?
No. Because you have seen how many products there are, like 2, 3. So it's kind of like, most of them are still in the phase where they're trying if their stem cell product works, and they don't have anything to sell yet. So they're always relying on the investors. And you can imagine that there is no really growth for a company there if they don't have anything to sell. So I would say there are kind of a couple of cell-based companies around. Most of them are small or medium-sized. And I think the large pharma industry is watching the field closely. And I think if there's a blockbuster, then yes, I think they will buy the company and make that kind of like part of their own portfolio. But big pharma is not investing in the field. So it's I would not recommend if you want to work in the industry. You have to think that maybe your company will be bankrupt in 2 years. If you're still interested, then it's an interesting field, but it's nothing stable.
Okay, that's all the questions. Thank you, Alexandra, for your talk, and thanks for coming. Next week's talk is given by the man who led the research into sequencing the genome of bonehead whale, which is the longest lived mammal. And so